Hello. Today we will focus on Chapter 8, which is on memory. And we defined memory as learning that persists over time. We made a very basic distinction between two important types of memories, one type being explicit or declarative memories, and the second type being implicit memories that require only automatic processing and do not require any kind of effort. An example of an explicit memory would be you're learning the material in the textbook and your notes for the exam. That's you're consciously and with an effort learning material that's part of your explicit memories. Implicit memories, as I mentioned, do not require any effort. They happen automatically. And a perfect example is something that we learned not too long ago about classical conditioning. Classical conditioning is a form of learning through associations. And for example, if I go to the doctor's office today and my heart rate goes up because last time I went, I got a flu shot and it hurt, that would be an example of classical conditioning. The kind of memory that I don't have to make any effort to remember. In this segment, I want us to focus only on explicit memories, and more specifically, I would like to spend the entire time just discussing a few strategies for effortful processing. They are extremely relevant to you as students, and hopefully you can use them as you're trying to successfully navigate college. And they are also going to be fairly highly represented on the exam. I would expect about 5 questions from effortful processing strategies to be on the exam. So let's delve right in. We talked about mnemonics. Mnemonics are memory aids. They're basically strategies for helping us remember things. So for example, we can strategize by trying to chunk random numbers. Let's say I have a set of 7 numbers, just a string like that. I can take those numbers and break them down into a set of 3 and 4 like we do with phone numbers. That's a pre-existing structure that we already have, a cognitive structure that you can put these numbers into, and that will hopefully help you in remembering it. That's an example of a mnemonic, a memory aid. Next, I want to discuss deep processing. Deep processing as opposed to shallow processing. And this is not going to sound new to any one of you because I have mentioned it quite a few times in class already. We know that deep processing trumps shallow processing. If you want to learn something well, if you want to remember it well, you want to shoot for deep processing as opposed to shallow processing. Shallow processing is basically just rereading the material or noticing that some words are bold and some letters are italicized, for example. That shallow processing doesn't lead to much learning. Deep processing basically means that you are accessing the meaning of what you're trying to learn. So for example, we had in class, somebody came up with the example of a purple plum. If you want to remember a purple plum, maybe you will think, oh, this is a type of fruit. Maybe you can even make it personal and say, this is a kind of fruit that I really like to eat. That kind of deeper processing will help you memorize the information. Visualization, imagery, is another type of strategy when we're trying to remember something that can really make a big difference. You may remember from class that I gave you a list of words. I'll read some of them again. Bold, truck, green, clips, hard, rope, knob, temper. And most of us agreed that the words that you can visualize, such as green, or rope, or knob, are easier to remember than the more abstract words or the words that are just not easy to visualize, such as temper or hard. And so to the degree you can visualize, imagery can make a difference. Next strategy. And this is something that will not sound new to you at all because I must have mentioned it many, many, many times by now. And that is the effect of spacing, spaced learning. The spacing effect, and many of you know this already, basically refers to the idea that we want to space out learning as opposed to cram in the last few days before the exam. That studying in smaller segments over an extended period of time is much better for remembering than cramming in the last few days. That is familiar to all of you. Let me mention a couple of more strategies that tend to be effective. One of them is hierarchical organization. Let's say I'm going to the supermarket and I left my shopping list at home, but I can recall in the car as I'm driving some of the things that were on my list. And I'm thinking, okay, bananas, strawberries, peppers, rice, cereal, raspberries, laundry detergent, dishwashing liquid. How am I going to remember all these things? It's a long list. One way to help myself, I can create a hierarchical organization of these different items. And I can say there's a category of fruit and veggies. Strawberries, raspberries, bananas, red peppers. There's a category of grains, cereal, rice. There's a category of cleaning products, laundry detergent, dishwashing liquid, etc. And the moment I organize these items into different categories, we call it hierarchical organization, at that moment, I'm going to be much more able to recall them later. Finally, something I want to mention that I have mentioned already before on these videos, and that is the power of personal connection to the material. Going back to the example of purple plum, if you want to remember purple plum for whatever reason, you can associate the purple plum as a type of fruit that you have some relationship to, that you like or dislike or are neutral about, okay? So let's say you really dislike purple plums. You just dislike plums. Maybe you have a reason, you had an experience. Flesh it out, imagery is helpful, but if you can also make it personal, okay, that one time when I ate it, that really didn't quite work for me. Or the opposite, it's just so delicious and juicy and I just love plums, right? The more you can make it personal, the more it will stick. On this note, I'm going to wrap up right here and I will see you next time.